And as you see it, what is the first order of business when Parliament gets back to business? There's a new opposition leader. Do you think that's going to make things a little more difficult to get consensus now?
Well, I think that remains to be seen. I think the expectation of Canadians is that their duly elected representatives of whatever party work together and bear down on the issues that matter most to all of us. And right now, there are issues like affordability and housing, obviously the transition to net zero. All these things, I believe, should require people. Yes, I take on board the fact that different parties coming from a different place on the political or ideological spectrum may have different public policy solutions or different tools that they might want to use to achieve outcomes. But I would hope that all our elected representatives are focused on the same outcomes, how we help Canadians afford a good quality of life, how we have an inclusive society in which we're using the productive capacity of all Canadians, how we're starting to put in place the building blocks to get us to net zero 2050. Those should be outcomes shared by all elected representatives, even though there may be different policy tools by which they would suggest we get there.
And let's just get into some of the elements that you had mentioned. Maybe let's start with climate. When you take a look at that climate plan in the U.S., what does Canada have to do to match those incentives?
I think Canada has to take on board very seriously what the Green Deal in the United States looks like and what it means, both for the United States and private sector and public sector investment in the U.S., and what that may very well mean here in Canada. My former colleague, Navdeep Bains, not too long ago, put out an opinion piece in which he described the Green Deal in the U.S. as really table stakes now for Canada and other countries like-minded in the world. And, you know, I think that's one way certainly of looking at the threshold or the floor in terms of what expectations will be of like-minded countries as we move forward through this transition, 2030, net zero, 2050. And I know from discussions with the private sector, parts of the private sector here in Canada, that they have crunched the numbers, Larysa, in terms of what the Green Deal might mean for various industrial sectors in the U.S. And they are having discussions. They're in town. I'm in Ottawa today. They're in town beginning to have those discussions with the Department of Finance and others because we want to attract foreign investment to this country. And we need to be very sensitive to the kinds of incentives and programs that are being put in place by our single most important trading partner, the United States.
Now, there was no war at the time when the coalition was formed. Of course, we are talking about the war in Europe, Russia's invasion of Ukraine. How has that changed what you do at the coalition? How has that changed how you think?
I don't think it does change how we think. It certainly has increased the level of uncertainty. And I think short term, although we do not know how long the war will last, we all hope it will end soon. But I think obviously it increases short-term pressures, whether it's around supply chain issues, logistics, food security, the price of oil, gas, and so on. But those are difficult issues. They play out here in Canada as they do in Europe, the United States, and in other parts of the world. But keep in mind, Larysa, that the coalition is actually focused on longer term economic growth, right? If you look at our scorecard, 21 metrics, which we will be tracking starting this year, at the end of this year, out till 2030, we are encouraging governments at all levels and the private sector, civil society, to focus on putting in place the building blocks to ensure that 2030, we are the most inclusive, most sustainable, most competitive economy in the world, or if not the most, certainly very much at the top of that list. So while our focus is longer term economic growth, there's no question that we have to take on board that there are short-term issues that are affecting our private sector, affecting the daily lives of Canadians. And it would be insensitive for the coalition, 137 members strong, not to acknowledge that governments need to, and we've seen this at the federal level recently, provinces respond to some of the short-term pressures that Canadians are facing. But we really want governments to focus on that longer-term economic strategy that ensures we are an inclusive economy, we are a sustainable economy, and we are competitive.
The federal election is in 2025. At that point, Trudeau's Liberals will have been in power for about a decade. The Conservatives electing a new leader, who needs to do what on that journey?
Well, keep in mind that the coalition, of which I am co-chair with my colleague Lisa Raitt, we are a nonpartisan body, and we leave the partisan politics up to others. But I think it's hard to predict what the world will look like in 2025. We certainly hope that inflation will be back to that 2-3% range, which the Bank of Canada and other central banks around the world are targeting. I think, would hope that many of the supply chain issues, the logistics issues, have been worked through. And clearly, we would hope that the war between Russia and Ukraine, the illegal invasion of Ukraine by Russia, will have been put behind us. I do think by 2025, there will be even more pressure to embrace the net zero 2050 economy and the building blocks that will be required, whether it's the Green Deal in the United States, the work that's being done here by the federal government and others. I think there'll be a greater emphasis on making sure that we are doing what we need to do to deal with the effects, both to adapt and mitigate the effects of climate change, but also put in place the steps, the incentives, the programs that get us to net zero 2050. But you know what? In politics, Larysa, as you know, a day can be a lifetime, as we've seen over and over again. So I think it's not easy to predict where we will be in 2025, but at the coalition, what we want, regardless of 2025 in terms of partisan politics, what we want is the focus on the steps necessary to have an inclusive economy, the steps necessary to have a sustainable economy, and governments, private sector, civil society focus on longer term economic growth. How do we grow the economy so we can sustain and enhance the quality of life, regardless of political party, I think we all want Canadians to have.
And just before we let you go, what do we need to do to grow Canada's economy?
Well, I think we grow the economy by putting all our productive capacity to work. right? We're leaving too much of it on the sidelines right now. When you think about Indigenous Canadians, when you think about Canadians, new Canadians, immigrant Canadians, we're leaving too much productive capacity on the sidelines. We can't afford to do that, whether it is in our healthcare system, whether it's in our manufacturing, and so on. We need to align government at all levels. We need to align incentives and programming with detailed and meaningful consultations with the private sector. What does the private sector need to be able to ensure that they have the talent for the future, that they're able to digitalize whatever it is they do so that they can be competitive and efficient with the rest of the world? Is the private sector putting on the table the funding to support research and development, retooling physically their plants, developing the intellectual property that is necessary, that is going to be the economy of the future? We need to get all those pieces working and pulling together. And that involves all levels of government, the private sector, educational institutions, civil society. This is a big lift, Larysa, and we all need to listen to each other and understand what we need to make that lift.